Good morning. We have with us Dr. Amit Shankar Saha, and today is the release of his second book of verses, Fugitive Words. I am, of course, the proud first customer of this book, a little boasting there. And Dr. Amit Shankar Saha is an assistant professor at CECOM Skills University and is also a renowned poet as far as contemporary Indian English poetry is concerned. Congratulations, Amit.
Thank you.
And how do you feel now that your second book of verses is out? How does it feel?
Obviously, the feeling is quite ecstatic. When my first book came out, it was like it took time to sink in. Now I'm more used to it. So like the book will release and these things will happen. There will be a launch and this and that. So now I am anticipating them, those events, and I know how they will feel. And then once something is done, then you have a feeling, okay, this is done. Now what next? So like it's a process, like a redoing a process. But now with full knowledge, full awareness, and like since a book is like a baby, so it feels good how the baby will grow and progress in the field of poetry, and how will the book will do.
So Amit, speaking of babies, your first baby was Balconies of Time, which was born in 2017. So how does it feel about your transition as a poet from Balconies of Time to Fugitive Words? How would you describe such a transition?
Transition can be in various ways. It can be into a different dimension, different sphere, as well as in terms of growth. So it can be lateral as well as vertical. So there is definitely growth. I have written better poems, and I have written diverse kinds of poems. So these two different areas of growth, both laterally as well as vertically, has enriched me as a poet. Has my experience as a poet, I feel more comfortable as a poet. Like I had started writing poetry long time back, but during my PhD days and all, I was engrossed in academic writing and all. And then to come back to creative writing and take up poetry again was a bit of a challenge. So once I started writing, I had to use a lot of crutches, a lot of support system. This I will use, I use a prompt or something like that. I attended a creative writing workshops and all. So those things helped me. But now I feel more comfortable writing even without any crutches or prompts. Obviously, there are phases where you will have a mental block. Like you may not be able to produce good poems. But again, it's a process. Whole thing is a process. You can never discount a poet as like, okay, he has reached a perfection. So a poet is always in the process of writing, and every day he will produce a poem, or like every at any interval of time he produces a poem. It is very difficult to judge whether this poem is better than his earlier poem. But any creative output is a growth, I believe.
Do you have any personal favorites among the poems in this book?
All are my favorites, because that those, because see, you write thousands or hundreds of poems and you select a few of them for your book. So those few are your favorites, definitely. Some may be because of some technicalities, because it is very well crafted. Some may not be very well crafted, but they have a personal, something personal with you. So you want them to be in the book, even though many people may not get it or will not find it very craftily written. But it's your personal favorite poem, that's why it's in the book. Maybe at some later stage, when I write my autobiography and all, people will discover, okay, this poem meant actually this, and that's why it was here. So otherwise, no one will understand that poem. One of the poem that I have written, it almost speaks about that thing.
Would you like to read it out here?
Let's see where I can find it. Yeah, the city in the night time. The city in the night time is very much the city I left behind. What difference does it make whether it is Bolpur or Kolkata? If I don't see it, it is the same city where you are awake late into the night and reply to my queries. That's our colorful secret. Secret as this poem is. A poem no one can read. So this poem is simple, like a poem. I'm almost stating that this poem no one can understand unless they know the context of this poem, and the, since I have not given the context, people may not be able to connect with it. But I have given enough enigma in the poem for people to speculate anything.
When your name becomes included in the annals of history of Indian English poetry, perhaps then you would like to explain the context, and perhaps teachers would teach students, you know, the context when they speak of the poem. You know, there should be a historical record perhaps.
Yeah, but like those historicist reading or biographical reading of a poem may not, it may not be fashioned. Like there are phases in theoretical development of theories of all kind of writing. Sometimes the text has all the meanings, sometimes no, you have to read a text beyond its periphery. So like what is the circumstances, history, author's intent and author's bio and all those things, culture things surrounding the text. So it depends on
depends
which
on
phase.
The approach that we are employing. A deconstructionist approach would
maybe
say
like
that
some,
there is no meaning in the text.
Yeah, and if a
no
kind of new criticism and all, they'll see no, a structuralism or something, will the meaning has to come from the words that are used in the text, irrespective of what the author intended or what other contexts are related to the text. So maybe something new meaning may be discovered in that very poem which I never intended.
Author's
intention
is not
supposed
to be
important. But maybe unconsciously it is ingrained in that poem.
So the possibilities are myriad as far as we can see. Well, we talked about literary theories, and that reminds me, of course, how can I forget or anybody else forget that you are an academician first and foremost. Academic writing is very different from creative writing. You know, the art and craft of crafting a poem is very different from writing an essay or writing a report in a journal. Do you find that there is a clash between, clash within you as far as the Amit the academician and Amit the poet are concerned?
Yeah, exactly. That is what I had mentioned earlier when I was doing my PhD. So I was totally into academic writing. Then it was very difficult to switch to creative writing. And after my PhD, I had to attend a few creative writing workshops to get again into that creative mode. So, but I knew it was with me, it will come back. Now the intensity of its coming back may vary with time, but it will be there. I know it will come back. So I just have to make a few effort. And the idea that like, that's why the very title of the book, Fugitive Words, these have escaped from me when I am not conscious of being a academician. So these at night when I am giving way to from a rational human being who will be checking PhD thesis and all, into a passionate human being who is whose words may not conform to academic register. So these are
want to say that poetry is an escape route for you or for the academic
From where I am escaping from? I am escaping from the academic register into a creative register. So that is an escape. But if I see that creativity is my natural state, so then that is not an escape. That was a diversion.
So do you consider creative writing as an escape route from the real world, from the reality?
It's an escape route from reality, but there are poems where you are reflecting reality in your poem, in your work. So like there are poems of like the dark time poems and all, they reflect the reality of the present time. So they are very topical poems.
So thank you, Jaguri. Thank you, Amit, for being here on the release of Fugitive Words, your second book. Hawakal congratulates you both. And thank you once again.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you.